So welcome to everyone, and thanks for joining us for IPECA's carbon pricing webinar. Before I hand over to our speaker today, I have a few logistical issues to run through. You've all been placed on mute today by default. Now, we can unmute you during our Q&A session at the end of the presentation, but for now, if you have any questions during the webinar, please feel free to post them in to us, and you can use the dialogue box, the Q&A box in the bottom right-hand corner of your screens. Please do also note that we will be recording this webinar and posting it on the IPECA website for those who can't join us today. So our third webinar, which is going to be on the Paris Agreement and the carbon markets that may evolve from the Paris Agreement, is going to be brought to you by André Marcoux. Unfortunately, Professor Stavins from Harvard, who we also invited to talk, has been unable to join us today. However, I'm very happy to say that André has generously offered to compensate for that by covering those areas of Rob Stavins' presentation as well. So thank you to André. Now, first of all, let me introduce our speaker. So André Marcoux is currently a senior fellow at the International Center for Trade and Sustainable Development, and he's also a senior advisor at the Center on Regulation in Europe. André has a long and illustrious career of being involved in climate change issues and, in particular, carbon markets. André was, since 1993, actively involved, including being the chief executive officer of BlueNext, the environmental exchange, and indeed the founder and president of IETA, the International Emissions Trading Association, whom we heard from in our second webinar. And of course, IETA are basically dedicated to the creation of robust, efficient, and environmentally sound markets for greenhouse gases. So, with that, I'm going to hand it over to André, and I'm just going to make you the presenter now, André, and hopefully we can hear from you.
Yeah, hi, Rob. Thanks, and thank you very much. How many people are on the call, Rob? Can you give me just a quick quick idea? So, because I have no clue who's – I don't know who's on the call.
No problem. So, today we have various IPECA members. There are 25 that I see currently connected, but they're from the various IPECA member companies.
Okay. All right. Probably know some of them or most of them. But
you'll certainly know some of them. You won't know others. So mixed audience.
Yeah. Anyway, thank you very much for the invitation, and hello from sunny Italy. Like, you know, I don't know where you folks are, but I'm in Italy and I'm enjoying the sun. So what I was asked to talk about Paris agreements and markets in perspective. You know, Rob Stavins couldn't be here, so I'll do the best to make up for that, what you're going to miss with Rob not being here. Now, I'll run you through this. I think Rob, you want to do the question at the end or as we go along. I'm in your hands on this. But look, what is the current situation in the market? And I think that you can get different views from different people. You heard my background, and the background that I have is comes from kind of running the association, but also running, you know, the exchange and being in Mercuria Energy Trading, which also trades oil and other commodities, but also as being a negotiator, because I do negotiate on a pro bono basis in my spare time for one of the G77 countries, and I'm also coordinator for markets co-coordinator for markets for G77 in China. So, you know, I've got a little bit of a different perspective on things. Markets 1.0 is the market that we have been living with and that we had such high hopes for those that were, if you want, support of markets, with, you know, what I would call a Cartesian but moribund market. It was Cartesian because in spite of different shortcomings of the Kyoto Protocol, the main one being the lack of graduation processes, it was nevertheless was very Cartesian, very, very orderly and very understandable, especially to carbon traders. It was essentially a giant cap and trade scheme. That's what it was. And it made perfect sense, actually, as long as and we're talking about the international markets, and you have to make a difference between the international and the domestic markets, because as you probably will know, you had a number of layers. So you had the layer of the domestic markets that were, at least in some cases, capping part of the economy in order to meet Kyoto obligation or some other obligation. But at the same time, there was superimposed on that at a higher level the Kyoto market, and that was indeed in order to deal with Kyoto obligations. They had the national obligation with domestic emissions trading systems that were not necessarily linked among themselves, but they were responding to, in most cases, the EU and the Japanese market were really very much dedicated or as dedicated to meeting the global Kyoto market. There's, of course, also the California, Quebec, coming up Ontario, New Zealand, Korea markets. These are pure national markets, and in some cases, they are linked. Now, it made sense because they were, you know, all adding up, and, you know, and the folks that were in Kyoto, you would add up the domestic obligations, and then you'd send them up to the, you know, through the EU, for instance, for the EU ETS, you send them up and kind of meet your sovereign compliance under the KP. Mm. Now, why is it moribund? It is moribund because it's really not doing much. One can argue, I produced a report not long ago on the state of the EU ETS. And the state of the ETS, we looked at a number of dimensions. And one of the dimension was very much whether the market functions. And the market as a function, it does function. You can't argue. I mean, it's always liquid. You can always get in and out. The spreads are tight. So you've got, you know, it's not a fully functioning market, but nevertheless, the liquidity has dropped down quite dramatically because many of the liquidity providers, not only due to the carbon market, but a variety of other regulatory and financial reasons have exited this market. Then many of the Geneva-based trading companies have exited the market. So some of the volumes have come down. It's not, they're not at dangerous levels, and there's not a problem, but nevertheless, it's not as it used to be. The second thing is, does it work in terms of providing providing a price signal for decarbonization? The answer will be, from what we see, would be squarely no, because it simply doesn't do that. I mean, Europe is more or less decarbonizing or meeting its carbon targets, but it is not because of the carbon price. And I think that the truest, I'm happy to get in that debate, but I just think this is a place and time. And in general, you know, I was, you know, Rob is not here, but I was invited by him at a seminar last week with about 20 people, David Victor, Matt Kahane, a whole bunch of people at Harvard. And we all agreed, if you want, I'm not sure whether we have the right to agree, but we agreed that the role of the carbon pricing right now is really marginal. It is not the main instrument. It is not driving. It is the one that's cleaning up what's left behind other policy measures. Now, seeing this, it is still there. It is still functioning, but it's not making an impression. And as such, there are many who are questioning whether this instrument, very interesting intellectually, is something that is really going to produce results in the long term. So what's happening? What's happening is that we are now trying to get into Markets 2.0. Markets 2.0 is it's being born.
but will it take off? And again, we're talking about the international market, meaning that at the national level, quite clearly, the EU is continuing its effort to reform and restructure the ETS. The Koreans are making efforts. The Chinese, presumably launching their own scheme. The New Zealanders, kind of going through their internal discussions in California and Quebec. But in terms of the international market, and this is our national effort, but the international market, will it take off? And the, you know, the underpinning for the international markets is, generally speaking, not always, but generally speaking, in the end, in my opinion, will be driven by the desire of parties to meet their international obligations. You would argue that is not the case of California and Quebec, and I can only agree with you to that. But I think that that's relatively unusual circumstances, which was a very political driven decision to link California and Quebec internationally without having any international higher level obligations, because the government of Quebec had a very activist premier and a chief of staff who used to be the chairman of AIDA, Dan Gagné, had pushed very hard for this link. But in terms of, it is a relatively unusual linkage. I'm not expecting too many of these that have not international obligations. So why is it a question of a takeoff? There is a virtual disappearance at this point of the international component. You see very little of the international market. The international market used to be very much driven by CBM and CER from CDM and joint implementation in ERUs. So there was a whole market and a whole bunch of people making a living of this and producing projects and transacting those credits. And that is virtually wiped out. That is, almost non-existent. There's also the second thing, but the second important element, is the lack of clarity on the governance of market and the Paris Agreement. We have agreed on something called Article 6 in Paris, and we'll talk in detail about that. But to quote one participant in a meeting in the Japan Brazil meeting that takes place in Tokyo in February all the time, we really haven't agreed much in Paris, and there's a lot of things that needs to be clarified. So that lack of clarity is impeding, I think, those institutions, whether national or private, who would think of hedging their carbon obligations for the future, to think about where to put their money. And that is, one of the reasons why Markets 2.0, the new markets, if you want, that we'll discuss now internationally, are really not taking off, and people are still in expectation. Now, I will switch, and this thing will move. Now, so there are a number of questions that one can ask in terms of governance, and we'll go into more detail, but the CMA is the short for the governing body of the Paris Agreement, the same way the CMP was the short name for the governing body of the KP. But a number of questions. What will be the role and oversight of the CMA under different paragraphs of Article 6? You'll see that While many have an interpretation, I think that there are hopes for different interpretation. Well, who sets the value of any domestically issued units in the Paris Agreement accounting system? If I translate a unit from Australia to transact a unit from Australia to the EU, the Australians and the Europeans agree that this is a ton, but is it a ton? And if I'm the list of 188 countries, do I agree that is a ton? Now, I'm not saying that it's going to be decided bilaterally or internationally, but it's a question. Does the CMA have oversight of the quality of the unit that being accounted for? Accounting means, in my mind, how you account and what do you account for? And, this is where accounting standards. And what are the lessons, governance lessons that are used from the operation of the KP mechanism, and what should be retained for the new mechanism being created? So there are many questions that people don't know. Do I put money right now in CDM projects? Will they be grandfathered? do I put money into red projects, and will they be coming under certain paragraph of Article 6 or different paragraph of Article 6? So it's quite a bit of uncertainty, and I think this is creating a bit of a freeze in moving forward. Now, the mainstay of market in the Paris Agreement is Article 6. Now, Article 6 doesn't say the word market, and Article 6 is the last piece that fell into place. Actually, fell into place about 12:45 on Friday night. With many of us had gone to sleep at that point, but it was an American-Bolivian agreement that led to the finalization and acceptance of Article 6. Why? Because, you know, and this has been going on for a long time. This particular part of the Paris Agreement had been kind of a football for the previous year and a half. And why is that? Because it is very important for an environmental integrity point of view. Paris, you know, there are two things that carry very big numbers in the Paris Agreement. One of them is markets, and so Article 6. The other one is Article 5, red plus. The numbers are so staggering in both cases that if you want to play, you know, kind of games with the numbers, you can drive a truck through these two articles. So the quality and the importance, that matter. Is there a connection to other parts of the Paris Agreement? There's Article 13, Article 15, Article 5, Article 4 on accounting. So transparency, the one on transparency, the one on compliance. There are different parts, and as such, they were being held back until those parts agreed. There were other issues to be traded, and there were finally an ideological opposition to markets. Now, the one thing that for those of you who are American, you know that you continue to interpret your constitution, and you have a bunch of people sitting in the Supreme Court trying to figure out why. What Franklin and the other framers of the Constitution had in mind when they did so. Well, in the case of Article 6 and the Paris Agreement, the people who wrote it are not dead. And as such, I think in interpreting the Paris Agreement and Article 6 on markets, there is a history. And that history is being framed by a number of drafts that the agreement has gone through and submission that has taken place. And in this case, you know, I've listed them in here, you know, and when I did my paper, this is what I've gone through. But I think there are two important ones. One of them is the Brazilian submission. Brazilians have a way of always being influential. In November 2014, when they made a submission where they talked about economic instruments. And the second one, which is also considered to be influential, I think both of them were less influential than maybe people figured, was a U.S.-Brazil submission that took place in December, and they also talked in which they made a number of proposals that were then to a large degree overridden. But the framework was there, and people liked that. Now, the scope of Article 6 on market, most people refer to this as having three pieces. One of them is the transfer of mitigation. One of them would be the transfer of mitigation outcomes, the ITMO, and that's Paragraphs 6.2 and 6.3, the one was mechanisms to support sustainable development. Some people call it SDM, 6.4, 6.7, and then a piece on non-markets, which is very much a Bolivian and ALBA piece, 6.8, 6.9. There is, however, a very important piece, and that is Article Paragraph 6.1. And why is that important? Because Paragraph 6.1, and we will see, talks about general cooperation. Many people think that this is a boilerplate article. In fact, I think that's wrong, and I think that the people who framed the final take-it-or-leave-it text either wanted to put a boilerplate or didn't know what they were doing, or they actually wanted to do this in a broad way, in such a way that you can drive a lot through it. And I'll go through it very quickly. Now, cooperative approaches, it's a broad article in the sense that covers markets, non-markets, and beyond. initially it was an article that talked about cooperative approaches, and it was very confusing because it was mixed up and in the same paragraph with the kind of the EU bubble definition, and in the end it was separated. The important thing is that recognizes cooperation but does not intend to provide permission to that cooperation. There was a very strong opposition from many, especially in the umbrella group, in providing or asking for permission to cooperate. There is a reference to sustainable development. Now, that reference to sustainable development, it's always an issue because it's also, you can assume that it's a boilerplate type of provision, or you can say that this is going to create problems in the future because it can be interpreted in any way you wish. It does talk about allowing for a higher level of ambition. Earlier drafts talked about enhancing a level of ambition, and there's a very fundamental difference here because the intention was, when you said enhancing, that you'd only use cooperative approaches in order to enhance your level of ambition. So your NDC, in order to go beyond your NDCs, you'd have the ability to use the cooperative approaches. There was strong opposition from many countries on both the G77 and non-G77. Not all of them, of course, but some of the G77 liked it. In the end, it was settled on higher level of ambition because the argument was, but I want to use the cooperative approach in meeting my current NDCs. I don't want to have to go beyond this in order to do that. That's why it's called NDC. And finally, the fact that the cooperation is voluntary is important. Now, if you talk about this in the under cooperative approaches, essentially it's cooperative approaches, folks. Anything goes. You can talk about technology transfer under cooperative approaches. You can talk about response measure under cooperative approaches. Like, to me, cooperative approaches, the way it's formulated, can be anything. It happens to be in the articles of cooperation, and then it goes further down in what looks like markets, but I think broadly you can think of it in a broader way. Now, the second article that is important, the second bit that is important, is the transfer of mitigation outcomes. That is Article 6.2 and 6.3, and it's quite clear from the very beginning that it's a special case of cooperation, and that special case of cooperation involves international transfer. This is what 6.2, 6.3 is. That when you have international cooperation, which involves this, you shall do a number of things. And that's what makes this special, this two paragraphs, 6.2 and 6.3. Now, what it says, again, is that it recognizes the cooperation, as in 6.1, because it's a special case, but it does not provide permission. So it's very important that parties involved into cooperation, whether bilateral, multilateral, whatever type of cooperation, they're not asking for permission for the CMA, but the permission is being, I mean, the cooperation is being recognized. It also is important that the transfers are not being qualified. It could be transferring anything. And when you talk about transferring anything, you're transferring international transfer mitigation outcomes. Now, this is a word that, or the expression that, frankly, I think we can, to some degree, a bunch of people that have worked together can claim, if we want to claim, if we're proud of it, I don't know, the parenthood of this, for the simple reason that we came up with this long, big box name because we could not say credits or allowances because we didn't want to limit ourselves. And as such, we came with the IDMO. But basically, IDMO means anything. You can transfer mitigation outcomes. Mitigation outcomes can be carbon units, could be renewable certificates, could be energy efficiency certificates, could be pretty much anything that you care to imagine. Now, 6.2 and 6.3 does not create a market. Let's be very clear. By neither was a market created under the Kyoto Protocol. The Kyoto Protocol created as this particular article, a framework for linking markets or doing international transfers. So what people wanted was that there will be the ability through the Paris Agreement to ensure that you can transfer mitigation outcomes between parties voluntarily, and that these can be used towards meeting your NDCs. And that's what this article says. Now, you can argue that this, you know, loosely, for those of you that are interested, this plays the same role as KP Article 310 to 312, which is accounting and says what you can account for, and Article 17, which allows you for trading of AAUs. Now, as mentioned, IDMOS is an acronym, is not a unit. Some people are beginning to imagine, again, it's quite interesting and in many ways funny when we get into meetings and we hear a lot of people beginning to speculate as to what may be behind this or that. But, you know, frankly, in many cases, we don't recognize the conversation because we negotiated this stuff and we kind of know what we had in mind. But some people are beginning, I've seen law firms beginning to imagine IDMO as being not a acronym, but an acronym. It's not a unit. It is simply an acronym that we use for shorthand. Whether you want to create one, that's a different story. But, you know, for the moment, it was not meant to be. The reason for creating IDMO was resisting to language. Sorry? Rob, did somebody want to say something, or should I go on?
I think you should go on, Andre.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. There are some cases in which units are not being issued. If you take the Japanese JCM, they're not necessarily issuing units, at least for, not for the moment. They're transferring big blobs of reductions or the mitigation outcomes between Indonesia. Well, they're not that big. They're like 45 or 50. Between Indonesia and Japan, but there are no units, so you can do, you doesn't have to be unitized. I think at some point you're going to have to count them in something. But this was very, very broad articles at the beginning. Now, what is the role of the CMA? This is, the role of the CMA is on paper, written down, it is limited to issuing guidance for accounting. End of story. That's what it is. If you read it factually, this is all it says. There's no CMA approval or conformity check required for any transfer. Is it? And that's what it is. However, and I have to say that however, there are hooks in there. And that leads you to think whether a modulation of interpretation is possible. Now, when you say that in doing your transfer, you shall transfer. I mean, this is IDMOs are a special case of cooperation. You shall transfer international mitigation transferable outcomes. Okay, and you shall follow the guidance of the accounting that is issued by the CMA, and everybody accepts that. But also talks about doing something about sustainable development, environmental integrity, and transparency in governance. If the UNFCCC shall is obligatory. So there are these shalls. So how are these shalls to be interpreted? So this is where the core comes in, and this is where right now some of the discussion is, how do we interpret this? And if you take some of the, if you're in developing countries, but not only developing countries, there are some middle income countries, you know, medium to small size countries that are using markets or intend to use international markets. They're also interpreting this in a little bit stronger way than saying all the CMA has authority to do is to issue this guidance and then it withdraws and does nothing else. Now, it says that parties apply the accounting in accordance with the guidance developed by the CMA. Now, the obvious question then becomes, who decides if the guidance observes and what happens if your guidance is not observed? The language is softer than in previous versions, In previous version is was stronger language, but nevertheless the question remains as to what happens. Is there a lateral, if you want, connection to the compliance article and the transparency article that allows you to become, to give the CMA a bigger role in what is on the face of it, an agreement between parties to transfer units or transfer outcomes. So is there more to it, or this is all there is? And this is where the, if you want, the lack of clarity comes in. And, if you take some umbrella group countries like the New Zealanders or the Australians or the Canadians or the Americans, they say, well, listen, guys, this is all it's saying. You shall produce guidance. If you don't produce guidance, then there's no guidance, then there's nothing to observe. And the rest, we don't have to tell you any, I mean, we don't have to observe anything. There are others who take exception to that and think that the CMA has some role in looking at the quality of the unit or the transferred outcomes because of it shall be in accordance with sustainable development and environmental integrity and so on. Now, this next slides come in. Sustainable development, environmental integrity. People consider that 6.2 and 6.3 are not product articles. They are not producing mitigation outcomes. It just talks about what happens when you transfer. So it's just concerned with the accounting, but not the production of these outcomes at the national level. So if that is the concept, what is the meaning of sustainable development and environmental integrity? I would argue that if you have a secondary market and you transfer EUAs within EU and Australia, that's a transfer. Thank you very much. And what is the meaning of environmental integrity and sustainable development in that context? Does that mean that then I all of a sudden, as the CMA or as some international body or some international process, I'm going to start looking at the quality of the EUAs being transferred and see whether they are in accordance with sustainable development and environmental integrity? That's a very dangerous slope because it may almost mean some interference or intrusion in domestic emission trading system, which obviously is unacceptable. Now, in terms of governance, it promotes sustainable development, environmental integrity, that there is a reference in the text for this, but how does this work? Let me explain to you one thing. The interpretation before Paris was that in this international transfer, you can have them governed on the continuum. In one side, when you make a transfer, you basically had to declare and tell the world what you did, and that was it. And people then will either say nothing or criticize you or compliment you on the quality of what you transfer and then using towards the NDCs. And as the other side of the spectrum was another school of thought that saw the international body and international governance having control under the quality of and the value of what is being transferred and accounted towards your NDCs when you have international transfers. So these are two different points of the spectrum. One of it being very loose, with just a declaratory type of approach. The other one was almost a recreation of the Kyoto Protocol, where the CMA as the new CMP would have jurisdiction to keep track and test the quality and the value of various units that are used for compliance. So what did Paris do? Paris didn't do anything. Paris did produce this Article 6, and the only thing that Article 6 does is changes the probabilities. And the probability is that we are much more towards a more decentralized governance, not declaratory, but certainly towards the declaratory end of the spectrum as opposed to the KP centralized governance that we had before. But has this thing been settled? The answer is no. but the probabilities have just very much increased that it's a much, much kind of bottom-up governance and decentralized governance as opposed to centralized government. That's what CAIR has done, because there's enough hooks that I explained to you which creates uncertainty as to if you do enter in certain deals and you transfer certain things, then you have a problem or may not have a problem. Now, also the other thing of accounting. Now, you know, it says that you have to be in accordance to the following the guidance of the CMA in accounting. But the language that it uses is almost non-English in my words, because it has to use towards you. It uses this transfer towards NDCs. What is towards NDCs? It doesn't want to say towards compliance with NDCs because there's no compliance. It says towards NDCs. But how do you do this stuff in a practical ways? Are these ITMOs, you know, put in an international transaction log? Is there a national registry that you put them in when you transfer, and at the end of the year you kind of retire them? Will there be serial numbers of some sort? I mean, there are very practical reasons, very practical questions for those of us that have been in the market, that we cannot function and we cannot put money on assets on that you don't know for sure that you have any ownership. And until that ownership and all these little details are clarified, my feeling is that private enterprises that are putting money at risk are going to be extremely reluctant to commit large pools of money to hedge their carbon risks through international transferring carbon markets. Now, a couple of questions, a couple of things in here. One thing that has been the flavor of the last year has been this club thing. And you know, people talk about clubs and you know, their coalition of the willing and we are, you know, that the Kyoto Protocol with all these things has not worked very well. So what do we do? So there will be a countries will not wait for the UNFCCC and the CMA, but they can do this using a club approach, and they will move forward. Now, one thing that you have to be very clear is that the clubs were not forbidden under the KP or the Paris Agreement. You could form clubs under the KP as well. There's a moral encouragement under the Paris Agreement, where the CMA has limited involvement in most, and the degree is to be determined. The infrastructure and the institutional arrangement infrastructure is not a CMA role on the face of it. So clearly there's some moral encouragement to go ahead and do things in small groups. Now, could this be an evolutionary process where you start as a coalition, as a first step, standard setting, and then you go further down the road in a club? Possibly. And what can a club do for you? I think that a club can provide you ready-made linkage conditions, because, you know, if you're a party or a country to negotiate all kind of rules, so linkage is it's a mess. You've seen it. Access to larger, more liquid and stable market. And what is very critical is addressing competitive issues, which will be critical in the future. And if you're part of the club and observe certain rules, you know, and it's written well on the WTO, you may be able to avoid any problem. If you're not part of the club, there may be a different type of reaction. Now, the second part to this is this sustainable development, what's called a sustainable development mechanism. I don't really like the name, but it was in the Brazil submission of 2014. The economics, there were two things. They were mentioned as the economic mechanism shall be comprised on emission trading and an enhanced clean development mechanism. That's what the Brazilian submission said. And the new market mechanism be established under the agreement, and so on and so forth. So basically, the Brazilians had in their own mind recreation of the Kyoto Protocol, Article 17, and the CDM under this Paris Agreement. That's what these guys liked, and that's what they wanted to do. And this thing doesn't, okay. So there are
Andre,
of
you've
that,
got about yes. 5 or 10 minutes. Thanks.
Yeah, well, you wanted a long speech. You got a long speech. Sorry about that. Maybe it's a little bit longer than I wanted to, but I was trying also to speak slower. Look, in terms of the SDM, I'll try and finish quickly. The nature on the governance is quite clear that the mechanism is established. The output is GHG emission reductions. It's operated under the guidance of the CMA or a body designated. It does produce something, so it produces reductions, mitigation outcomes. The question is, how do you do further international transfer? So if you do this in initial issuance, then you have to transfer in the secondary markets, and we all assume that the secondary market will be done at a 6.3. And the support is, so there's some discussion about the preeminence or the balance between this being a mitigation mechanism and the support for sustainable development. That's why many people are not very comfortable calling it a sustainable development mechanism, because it gives preeminence or primacy to sustainable development as opposed to mitigation. And I think most people think of this board being a mitigation mechanism that does not contradict sustainable development. Now, two things that are important, and they were not in the Brazilian submission and EU submission, was the fact that the initial thought was that you could put this mechanism to work in developing countries, and then the product could be used by developed countries. And that created a bit of a storm, because there are countries which are, especially countries that may want to use the product of this mechanism, but which are now middle-income countries, and that foresee that within 5-10 years may actually want to use the output of this mechanism. And in the end, what we ended up with, this mechanism can be used in any countries to produce reductions, and the output can be used by any country in meeting its NDCs. The one issue that is important is the overall mitigation. There's a sentence in there, there's 6.4 something, that talks about having overall mitigation, global mitigation. That's unclear what it means, and there's no definition for that, but has importance because of the accounting implications. So if you don't use it as an offset, meaning a one-on-one deduction between Indonesia and Germany, and you use a 1 to 0.5 translation, 0.5 of it gets lost somewhere, and somebody makes a donation to nature. Who makes that donation is important, because somebody pays the bill. And if I'm the exporter, which I expected to be developing countries, obviously I'm going to object that I'm a poor country and I'm going to make a donation. So why don't you guys, who are the users of this stuff, at least at this time, make the donation? The other thing that we have is the share of proceeds, and there's a clear reference to participation of private entities, and that's important because it provides, as in the Kyoto Protocol, the opportunity for private entities to participate. The one thing is that people see more and more in this Article 6.4, 6.7, and many people see this to be used for financing for results. And the feeling is that before we get in an international market, there's going to be a lot of financing for results. And that's where the feeling is, that 6.4 could be used for this particular avenue. The final thing that I wanted to say is RED Plus. RED Plus, Article 5, not Article 6, Article 5, for almost the whole period of the year and a half preceding the Paris Agreement, was known as the RED Plus mechanism article. And in the end, this name fell off and ended up with Article 5, which is a description of kind of land use and RED. The question is, if you want to do RED through mechanism, how do you do this? And there's two school of thoughts. One of them is, well, listen, I've got the Warsaw Agreement, Warsaw Framework to do RED Plus under the UN rules, and I do it bilaterally or small plurilateral under 6.2, 6.3. There's another bunch of people who say, yeah, but if I want to do it and have a UN stamp, then I better do it under 6.4, 6.7. The risk is for those people that have developed the Warsaw Framework for RED Plus mechanism, that if you want to use 6.4, 6.7, then what you have to do, you have to develop modalities and procedures for this new mechanism. And that implies that the Warsaw Framework has to be reapproved by the CMA. There's a lot of reluctance to, after having negotiated Warsaw Framework for years, to resubmit it and reopen it to be accepted. So my view is that probably most people, at least at the beginning, will want to stick to 6.2 and 6.3 and do this bilaterally or small fluid laterally with very little direct, if you want, interference from the CMA and the FCCC apparatus. Yeah, sorry about this. It's a little longer, but I hope that's okay.
No, that's great. Thank you very much, Andre, for that comprehensive walkthrough of the Paris Agreement. And so at this point, I can unmute people's lines and ask if there's any questions. And if you are not asking a question, if you could put yourself on mute now using your own phone lines, that would be helpful.
Hi, Renato speaking from Romania. I have a question for Andrei. Andrei, thanks for the presentation. It was full of details and gave us the opportunity to understand also the difference and, I mean, several aspects of Article 6. That seemed to be a very simple article, but actually it leaves open lots of options. I wanted to understand from you, since you are a very, I mean, with great experience, a negotiator, what can come out from COP22? Do you think that anything really concrete, a little step forward, can be expected in Marrakesh?
Look, my sense is that what you will come up from Marrakesh is disappointing. I don't think that you. I think you're going to come up with a work program out of Marrakesh to come up with the accounting modalities and procedures for 6.2, 6.3 and the accounting for 6.2, 6.3 and modalities and procedures for probably what is the CEM in 6.4, 6.7. There is no pressure right now, Renato, for this to be used. Nobody, the big ones, the U.S. Canada, maybe a little bit more, but EU, China, they're saying they were not going to use international markets, at least at the beginning. And as such, there's not an enormous amount of pressure. The only people that are pressuring for this are Norwegians, Swiss, New Zealanders, Koreans. So these are smaller countries that wish to be ambitious and that are for whom the marginal abatement costs are expensive. So there is not the pressure to move. And as such, I think that other things will be prioritized in Marrakesh. So I think that if you expect to have a tradable commodity post Marrakesh, I don't think so.
Okay.
So again, guys, if you're not asking a question, could you please mute your line? Because there's a lot of background noise here. So please all mute your lines unless you're going to ask a question. So and I'll open it out now to anyone else who wants to ask Andre a question. So, Andre, I'm going to ask you a question then at that point. So you clearly indicated that the Paris Agreement body, the CMA, won't be won't create any kind of verifying bodies or clearing houses around this. So do you have any feel yourself for where these might come from? Are they going to come from regional trading schemes?
Well, I think that people look, I mean, carbon markets, you know, I think the dream of carbon markets as being the arbitrage between different energy sources and the carbon price, I think that for a number of reasons has not come to pass, or not yet. So I think that the carbon market, if the price and cost becomes a more important element in business decision making, is going to be very much driven by normal trade flows. flows. So you will probably see where the trade flows and the trade groupings come together. You may see people coming together in small clubs or small joint declarations or small, if you want, or common standards and infrastructure, because this is where most of the normal trade occurs. And this is where the need for ensuring that you have some clarity and lack of double counting and whatever in the carbon market. So my expectation is that either there is going to be like a NAFTA agreement between Mexico, you know, U.S. and Canada, maybe an East Asia agreement. But also there may be groupings that come together in an ad hoc way. And the more important one that is emerging, even though it hasn't made a lot of progress since Paris, is the New Zealand one that is, you know, they signed, including Panama, they signed 18 countries to come up with an incipient carbon club. And I know for a fact that they're working on a number of environmental standards to reassure the international community and stakeholders that they are going to be very careful about environmental integrity and international transfers. So in my opinion, somebody's going to have to kick the ball, and that is going to be around trade or around voluntary groupings that want to come together to create a critical mass. I think that there are other initiatives like this G20 initiative that some people look at, but that initiative will be less so. I think that initiative is more of a political dialogue, like the CPLC, as opposed to the technical body of knowledge. I think the technical body of knowledge will emerge on a regional and trade-oriented block basis.
Great, thanks. And then do you see those regional, you know, I guess looking out presumably beyond sort of 5 years or so, possibly the CMA might take a future agreement to actually implement some of these bodies once the regional trading schemes have enough impetus behind them?
Well, I think that for the moment, at the price of, or the price of 5, 6, 7 euros a ton, you know, I know that many are complaining, but in reality, it's not a factor. I do not believe that it's a factor in investment in many cases. Now, in the future price, it is, but this price is not. Now, however, the movement to a more coordinated, asymptotic price is not driven by the cost. I think it's going to be driven by the competitive pressures that are beginning to emerge between countries. And as such, I think that these clubs are going to come together to ensure, or in the international agreement is going to have to be made around ensuring that there is no competitive advantage for those that do not put carbon a price on carbon. Right now, that protection for competitive and carbon leakage is being offered at a national level, mostly through free allocation. But this cannot continue forever. I mean, I know it's the favorite baby of all the countries because it's simple, and all the probably many of your members on the call are fighting a very hard and bitter fight to make sure that they do get full compensation for the cost in the UETS in phase four. But there is a point where mathematically it doesn't make sense. There's just not enough free allocation to do that. So that issue is going to have to be internationalized. It is at this point where I think that this whole issue of cooperative agreements within the next 6, 7 years is going to come really to the fore. But it may come not necessarily as driven by linkages and trading. Is going to become more to as a result of the pressure that national prices are putting and to ensure that you have a level playing field and not national protection measures.
Yeah, great. Thank you. Any final questions? We're in the closing minutes of our webinar now. Do we have any final questions for Andre? Okay, in which case, it just leaves me to thank you very much, Andre, for your time and knowledge today. It certainly clarified in my mind what the Paris Agreement did and did not do. And thank you to all of our attendees. So thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye bye.
Cerco di girarti tutto.